Welcome everybody to Seattle Central College. On behalf of the Seattle Central Student Leadership, the College Activities Board, specifically the Creative Arts Series, the Cultural Events Committee, and the Activities Committee, we're very honored to have this special event here on this campus. I'm not going to be the one introducing our featured guest, but I do want to acknowledge those that helped put this together, the students, as well as the AFT, John Martinez and the AFT Faculty Union, and Lyle from Multicultural Services. So the person who's going to introduce us is known within the circles in Seattle. He's born and raised here, but currently a wayfarer and a poet-musician, Baraka Blue. Please give him a warm welcome.
Bismillahi Rahman Rahim. In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. Brothers and sisters, good morning. It's quite early. I greet you with peace. Assalamu alaikum. It's my honor to introduce Dr. Umar Faruq Abd-Allah, our speaker this evening. Dr. Umar is an American Muslim born to a Protestant family in Columbus, Nebraska. He grew up in Athens, Georgia, where both of his parents taught at the University of Georgia. He did his undergraduate work at the University of Missouri with dual majors in history and English literature. In his last year there, he won a Woodrow Wilson Fellowship and entrance to Cornell University to pursue a Ph.D. in English literature. However, shortly after coming to Cornell, Dr. Umar read the Autobiography of Malcolm X, which was to be a very pivotal and transformational moment of his life and was his door to enter Islam. He subsequently altered his field of study and transferred to the University of Chicago, where he studied Arabic and Islamic studies and received his doctorate with honors for a dissertation on the origins of Islamic law. He taught at the Universities of Windsor, Ontario, Temple, and Michigan. He then went to Spain to teach Arabic in Granada. And in 1984, he was appointed to the Department of Islamic Studies at the King Abdul-Aziz University in Jeddah, where he taught Islamic studies and comparative religions for several years. During that time, he studied with many of the greatest scholars and spiritual masters in Arabia. And he spent 16 years there. He returned here to America in 2000 under the auspices of the Nawawi Foundation. He is currently engaged in independent research, writing, and teaching activities with institutions across the United States, Europe, and Africa with a focus on Islamic theology. The topic today is about Muslims in America before Columbus, and it's a timely topic because, of course, many quarters of our land are questioning whether Muslims belong here, including the individual who holds the highest office in this land. And perhaps it's quite ironic to find that maybe even before Columbus, the Muslims were here. And definitely, the Muslims have been here at least since many of them were brought in the transatlantic slave trade. So I think, though this is a historical talk, it is very, very profound in this historical moment. Please join me in giving a warm round of applause to Dr. Umar Faruq Abd-Allah.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of God, the Compassionate, the Merciful. Thank you very much for coming. And thank you, Baraka Blue, for the introduction. I want to emphasize the question mark at the end of the title. So it's Muslims in Colombia, in America before Columbus. I don't want to make any assertion in this talk that they were actually here. We have evidence, and it's not all about Muslims. In fact, it doesn't even begin with them. It begins at some of the evidence, and in this process also we want to look at some of our paradigms and cognitive frames, the way we think about things. Because often if the cognitive frames and the paradigms are not correct, then it's impossible to see what the information means, even though to you or to others it might be as clear as it could possibly be. So let's begin with this presentation, with the first slide. And again, I have to say that I don't know if among you there are people from the First Nations of these lands, and whether they are here or not, in a topic like this, one must be very careful not to offend them and not to presume to speak about their origins and not to presume to give their own foundational stories a different turn, because that would not be right. And I don't want to do that. I don't want to even approach that. But we will begin with the issue of how did we get here in the first place. And the story, which is no doubt true, but it might not be all the truth, is that the Bering Strait had a land bridge, which is called Beringia, that was formed during the Ice Age from the period of about 16,500 to 11,000 years ago. And generally, when we talk about how did the First Nations come to this land, we're told that they came that way. And there's no question that they did. But is that the only way they came? This is what we'll be looking at. And when we talk about Beringia, also, there's certain issues here, because that was the Ice Age. And as you know, the glaciers were very many, and they were very big, and they were very treacherous, and they were very difficult to cross. And Beringia had glaciation. Siberia didn't have glaciation. It was very cold, but it didn't have glaciers. So the general idea is that it wasn't that difficult for people to go up into Siberia. But once they get there, then they'll cross this land bridge, which is very large, and they'll come into North America, and then they come down. We're not here to question that that happened. However, we might also say, did it only happen by land? So let's take the next slide. And here, we want to look at cognitive frames, because the idea that people couldn't use the sea, or they couldn't use rivers, is that true? And many people seem naturally inclined to that point of view from the very beginning. So, in the 20th century, you had a number of people. Thor Heyerdahl is one of the most well-known. I don't know if the young people here know about him. I knew that when I grew up, which was a long time ago, that Thor Heyerdahl was one of the most fascinating and popular of all people. And he believed that the Americas were also populated by sea, and that although Beringia works, that it wasn't necessarily the only way. And he says here in a book, which is Man Across the Sea, man hoisted sail before he saddled a horse. He pulled and paddled along rivers and navigated the open seas. The open seas is very important. Before he traveled on wheels along a road, watercraft were the first of all vehicles. With them, the Stone Age world began to shrink. By hoisting sail or merely traveling with the currents, early man was able to settle the islands. And to show that that could be done, then he built the Kontiki, which was the Polynesian raft, and he crossed the Pacific Ocean to South America, using the Black Current. That was really famous, and there were movies about it. His book, Kontiki, was a book that everyone read. And then he thought that
Even using an ancient Egyptian boat, one could have done the same thing on the Atlantic. Again, using the currents, the equatorial current. And he built, in 1970, he built the Ra. He built the Ra one before that. And of course, it looks like this. It's an Egyptian reed boat. And when he built it the first time, he had it built in Central Africa, where you have people that still build reed boats. And he didn't run a rope from here to the mast and down. Although the depictions of the ancient Egyptian boats have that. And so he didn't make it across, because by the time that he almost had crossed the Atlantic, the boat had become waterlogged and the front of the boat began to sink down and the boat was not seaworthy. Instead of giving up, he decided, let's just make the boat exactly like the Egyptian pictures show and run the rope to the mast and to the back, and then he crossed. So he showed that that boat was, in fact, seaworthy. That, of course, doesn't prove that that actually happened. But he wanted to show people that it was possible. Let's take the next slide. So one of the most important things when we talk about this issue of pre-Columbian America and who came and how they came and when they came and whether they came is to talk about the sea. And people who know the sea, they know that one of the most important things about it are the currents. And some of these currents are like conveyor belts. They're very strong. And interestingly, the great currents will bring you to America. This is the black current. This may be the black. These are the Pacific currents. Then you have here the equatorial current that comes down the coast of Africa, goes across the Atlantic, and it comes into what we call the contact area, which is southern Mexico and the Caribbean and northern South America. They call that the contact area. Because, and this is what we'll be looking at the most, even if we were going to go back to Beringia, the Bering Strait, I mean, you know about the First Nations of this wonderful city and this wonderful area, and you know, of course, that they are sea people. They are boat people. I don't know enough about them to know about how they conceive of their past or when they got boats or anything. But of course, and it's natural that they would be sea people living in this area. But again, if we were to go back and look at Beringia, then you'll see that this current comes right on the coast of Beringia and down into Alaska, into California. So it is possible, maybe even likely, that even some of the First Nations who crossed on Beringia, they did so by boat. They did so by raft. That's the safest way to go. And the currents are there. And moreover, as we said before, one of the big problems with the population through Beringia is how did they cross the glaciers when they got over? Because that's not easy. That was the age, the ice age. So even crossing Beringia by land is much more difficult than by sea. And then once you cross, crossing the glaciers down to the area south of the glaciers, which would be almost this far down, that's also going to be difficult. But if you're going by sea, by raft, maybe they had boats like the canoes, then actually it's not that difficult of a journey. And you can always stay inside of the coast. So again, this is an important example of cognitive frames, paradigms, the way we think of it. Whatever actually happened, and we hope that whatever we say happened is true, but we've got to think about the way we think. And the person who says that it's just Beringia and it's just land, well, it's like probably they have a cognitive frame that doesn't understand the way the oceans are made. And the fact that these conveyor belts, if you get in them, by choice or by mistake, they will take you. You'll have a hard time getting out of it. If, for example, and let's look at the next slide. I didn't know that was the next slide. But if you get into the equatorial current, you know, the one that goes from Africa to the contact area, you would have a great difficulty not coming to America. In 50 days, your boat will either be here or it will be washed up here. And whether you're still alive or not, that's another question. And no doubt, if people cross the ocean to the Americas, then no doubt some of them may have done it intentionally. And others probably did it by mistake. They got swept off, they got caught in the current, they survived the crossing. And then in 50 days to 60 days, they were in a new land. There's almost no doubt that that also happened. Is that all that happened? I'm not sure. But now, again, we look at the oldest evidence of human beings that we know of in America. And we say in Arabic, عدم الوجد لا يدل على عدم الوجود. The fact that you didn't find something doesn't mean that it wasn't there. So we have to always be careful to know that because, you know, we don't know that this is the first American. The first person to be here is just the first one we've discovered, and we discovered her by chance. And this is a woman who was named Naya. It is the oldest human skull that we've found so far. She probably died between 1300 and 1200 years ago. She probably lived during the time of Beringia. This is the time when the land bridge was there, and it had already been there for a few thousand years. So she could have crossed that way. There's no question about that. How did she get so far south? And why did she and her people go so far south? Well, maybe that's not a problem either. But the thing is that she was discovered here. This is, of course, southern Mexico. This is Yucatan. And this is also the contact area. In other words, this is where the equatorial current will come into America from Africa. And her skull has been reconstructed. Perhaps she looked like this. Probably she looked like this. She looks to me African, and that's also very interesting, because if she was an African, as she appears to me to be, then the idea that she crossed from Beringia is a little bit difficult, in fact quite difficult. Let's look at the next picture. This is the second oldest human being that we found in these continents. And she's about 1,000 years or so after Naya. They call her Lucia woman. She's believed to have lived about 11,500 years ago. And after Naya, she ranks among the most ancient humans found in America. Again, where was she found? So she was found in Brazil, and in Belo Horizonte, and as you can see, in southern Brazil. So this is very interesting. You know, again, it could be Beringia. We can't rule that out. But she also looks very much like Naya. Would you agree with that? She looks like she could be Naya's cousin, maybe Naya's descendant. And to me, she has a certain African quality. Of course, we don't know what color her skin was. The forensic artist made her this light brown color. If we knew what she looked, what color she was, whether she was black or that color, that might also indicate more clearly where she came from. But she certainly, it's certainly possible that she came from Africa. Let's go to the next, and this is the cave where she was found in southern Brazil. Let's go to the next slide. So here, I want to look at what is the oldest known civilization in America. And many of you know about these great people, the Olmecs. They flourished in the contact area. They flourished in Yucatan. Between 1500 BC, BCE before the Common Era, BC before Christ, to about 400 BC. Of course, this is a long time after Naya and a long time after Lucia. However, one of the things that is striking is that although Naya and Lucia looked African, these do too, don't they? It's interesting that some histories, I know a history of early America in which certain scholars from a certain European country, they write about the early history of ancient America, and they talk about the baby-faced Olmecs. And to me, it's like, you really don't want to say the African-faced Olmecs, do you? And is that a baby face? This is a warrior's face. And in fact, he even has a helmet. And in fact, that helmet is virtually identical to West African helmets, the Mandinka helmets. So here again, we're faced with a number of issues. I would say that one of the most important is the issue of cognitive frames and paradigms. That certain people, I think, simply cannot conceive, for whatever reasons, that Africans could have gotten here. And so to look at the obvious and say, but this is an African, which if he were discovered in Africa, there would be no issue with at all. But the thing is, he's discovered in southern Mexico. And so therefore, the issue of cognitive frames come in. Some people simply cannot conceive of that. And let's look at the next slide. And these were great rulers. Another Olmec. Does he look any different? Of course, he looks distinctive. This is a different individual. But he's also very clearly an African. And he's got a Mandinka helmet. Let's go to the next one. These are other Olmecs. There's about 19 of them, of these, that we found, all in the same area. And you notice that each one is individually different. Each one of them must represent a different person who, I would say, existed, who was there. And is there any question in your mind that they look African? And it's amazing how difficult that is for some people to admit. Maybe that's racism. And maybe it's just cognitive frames. Maybe it's cognitive frames conjoined with racism. But to me, there's no question. And whether these are Mandinkas, for example, who are a dominant people in West Africa, or Bambara, one of the interesting things about the Mandinka is, and they're a big people in West Africa, they're also a dominant people, they have lines of kings, they were very important in West African history, but the Mandinkas say our traditions go back 10,000 years. Of course, do we know that to be the case? I don't think that's been proven to be the case, but that's what they believe. And they know that they have traditions that go back very far in the past. And if these people were, for example, associated with them, that would be much less than 10,000 years ago. Let's look at the next slide. Now I want to introduce to you a book I believe is worthy of careful study. Some people have given it careful study. This is a book written by Leo Wiener, who was an Austro-Hungarian Jew. He lived from those dates, died in 1939. He was a brilliant linguist. And he was at Princeton, he was at other schools. He undertook to study the languages of the Caribbean. He studied Arawak, Carib. He studied also many other languages, but in his study of Arawak and Carib, he claims to have discovered, and you can look in the book, he gives you the word lists, he claimed to have discovered that these languages had in them Arabic words. But then he claimed also that they were Arabic words that did not come through Arabs. How could a linguist make such a claim? Well, they have tricks. And one of them is that West African languages, for example, and many African languages, they have certain sounds and they lack other sounds. So there are Arab sounds like Z, which you have, Z, and they don't have that. So they won't say Zayn, they'll say Jane. They won't say Zainab, they'll say Jainab. And you have other examples of that phenomenon. So he noticed that these must be Arabic words, but they're not coming through Arabs. They're almost certainly coming through Africans. And so then he wrote his book, Africa and the Discovery of America. This came out, if I'm not mistaken, in the 1920s. Was it welcomed in white supremacist America? Well, take a guess. It was actually, I think, a courageous work. And I think, you know, we should acknowledge the greatness of this man. And it is a careful study. It might be sometimes that he's over-enthusiastic, as some people are when they've discovered something new, and he wants to press the point home. But he doesn't just look at language, he looks at plants, he looks at wampum, he looks at all sorts of different things. Let's keep going. Now here is a book that is to be connected with this whole study that really, to my limited knowledge, begins with Leo Wiener. And this is an archaeologist, Alexander von Buchenau, fundamentally concerned with ancient American archaeology. I think he's an Austrian, he might be a German, and he has works that are, again, worth reading. Unexpected Faces in Ancient America, 1500 BC to 1500 AD. In other words, coming right up into the Columbian period. He said, let the Mesoamerican terracottas, Mesoamerica, of course, means Middle America, which is Yucatan, Central America, and so forth. He said, let the terracottas speak for themselves. And they declare that not only East and West, but in fact the whole world met a long, long time ago in Mesoamerica, Middle America. And maybe that's the only place that happened. But this is what we're talking about here. And he's saying that, and one of the interesting things about the First Nations of Mesoamerica is that they made these terracottas. These are examples of the terracottas. And presumably these are the faces of real people. And you have people that look definitely Oriental, Japanese or Chinese. Those are there. They're not there in the picture you see. They probably, if they came, would come by the black current. You have people that he would say, this maybe looks like a Phoenician. He's got a beard, anyway. They might say that looks like the European. I don't know actually what he says. And this looks like an African. So the terracottas are very interesting. There are thousands and thousands of these terracottas. The terracotta is a statue made of clay. And then it is fired like a pot, so that it becomes very hard. And mostly he studies the terracottas. And here also I mention diffusionist versus inventionist. These are two anthropological schools that pertain to the study of early America. The diffusionists believe that people came from overseas, meaning also from like Africa, from the Orient, Japan, and elsewhere, and that they diffused cultural ideas among the First Nations. Of course, a theory like that is going to offend some people. It's going to offend a lot of First Nations because they have gone through cultural genocide anyway. And then to come to say, but you didn't even make your cultures, well, that's not going to be acceptable. And we have to be very careful how we talk about these things, and we have to also be very clear that America is a big place. And it doesn't mean that the same story and the same paradigm applies to everyone. And then you have the inventionists, and they hold the other argument. They say, no, the First Nations of these great lands, they invented their cultures. And they should be given credit for their cultures. Of course, they should be. And they had great cultures and great civilizations. But again, this is an academic argument which has political and sociological and cultural overtones. And we have to be sensitive to that. Again, does it have to be all or nothing? Does it have to be either or? Couldn't it be variations, and couldn't it be somewhere in between? Why do we have to take one position or the other? And I would say be careful of that. One scholar whom I admire very much, who is one of our contemporaries, an African-American, Dr. Sherman Jackson, he says, beware of the false universal. Beware of the false universal. These sweeping generalizations that don't allow for exceptions. And the very idea of diffusionism or inventionism, to me, it brings on the point of being a false universal. But significantly, both diffusionists and inventionists agree that people from greatly diverse ethnic groups over Eurasia and Africa, or from Eurasia and Africa, are represented in the archaeological record of ancient America. So that they don't dispute. In other words, people did come here. And that would also mean necessarily that they came by sea. Again, probably by these great currents. The inventionists would say that they came, but they didn't do it, and they should not be credited with the creation of the American cultures. And in any case, all these things would require proof, wouldn't they? They require a careful investigation and sensitivity, you know, to the realities that people live today. Especially, as we said before, people like the great First Nations who have undergone cultural genocide of the first order. Let's go on to the next slide. So this is actually one of the big things that Leo Wiener is getting at. And here you have an artist representation of one of the great kings of history. This is Mansa Kankan Musa. He was the king of the Empire of Mali. And the Empire of Mali, which had Timbuktu and what is today Mali, Senegal, the Gambia, parts of Guinea-Conakry, Guinea-Bissau, Burkina Faso, this was a big kingdom. And it was a wealthy kingdom. It was the most wealthy in the world because it had so much gold. It had so much gold. Mansa Kankan Musa made pilgrimage in about, I think, 1325. And his soldiers, when they went with him to pilgrimage, they caused inflation in Cairo for about 12 to 15 years because of the abundance of gold that they brought. And his soldiers who made pilgrimage with him, by the way, they could wear skins, they could wear different kinds of clothing, but they wore Persian brocade. And also, they had in their economy, they used seashells for their small currency that came from the Maldive Islands. So I just mentioned that because of the fact that we live today in a global world. And we must be very careful not to imagine that global civilizations didn't exist before. Because the Kingdom of Mali was part of a global civilization. And therefore they had contact with Persia and with India and with the Indian Ocean and where else. One of the things that the Mandinka say, he is a Mandinka. And by the way, compare his headdress with the Olmec statues. See, that's a Mandinka helmet, but it's also a Mandinka crown. Doesn't it look similar? Yes, I think it does. So, anyway, Mansa Khan Khan Musa is one of the great rulers of history. But the Mandinka who say our traditions go back 10,000 years, okay? They say the world is old, but the future springs from the past. These are words of wisdom that I love, and I think they're very true. This is also why it's so good to know the past and to discover the past. And the real past, that is the past of your ancestors, and our ancestors is often very different from what's written in the books. But that's in you, and it will be in your future. Whatever is there, and that's why it's good to know it. You won't be so surprised by what happens. Let's go to the next slide. This is an Arabic text. I took it from a manuscript. I'm the one who made the ugly lines there. And this is from a book by Al-Umari, that's how you pronounce that word. And that's his last name. And his Shihab al-Din Ahmad ibn Yahya. He was an Arab historian who lived from about 1300 to 1384. And he gives us a report from Mansa Khan Khan Musa when he made pilgrimage. Now if you look at the dates, when Mansa Khan Khan Musa made pilgrimage, he would have been about 25 years old. So he didn't actually hear the report. He heard the report from somebody else, a person in the Egyptian court. But he tells us about it. And this is the Arabic text. And it's in a book that's called Masalik al-Absar fi Mamalik al-Amsar. That's the Arabic. And it's roots towards insight into the capital empire. And one of those capital empires is Mali. So he wants to talk about Mali. And let's look at the translation of the text. Next slide, please. So this is my translation of it. What Mansa Musa reported about his brother and predecessor, Mansa Khan Khan Abu Bakr II. Okay, so he's asked in Cairo, how did you become king? And so he says, we are a noble family, we are a royal family, who inherit rule from each other. The one who preceded me, Abu Bakr II, that's actually his brother, did not believe that it was impossible to attain the furthest limit of the Oceanic Sea, which is the Atlantic Ocean. He wanted to attain the sea's utmost limit. In other words, he wanted to cross the Atlantic. Okay, why did he want to do that? But he did. Became enamored of the idea. He fell in love with the idea. And prepared 200 ships filled with men. An equal number of them he filled with gold. So there are 400 ships. And they're probably outrigged. And what is outrigging? It's when you take one boat, especially like a canoe, or a canoe-like boat, and you attach it, usually by poles, to another one. And you've seen that, right? That's outrigging. And that kind of a boat is difficult to sink. And it may be quite ocean worthy. So this is probably what they did. And that's something known in West Africa. And also the kingdom of Mali was a river kingdom. It's a big landed kingdom, but it uses the rivers and it has power canoes that it uses to police the rivers, to protect the rivers, to travel. So he prepared 400 boats, probably outrigged, one of them having warriors and the other one having provisions. So he put in those gold, water, and provisions. Some of them were filled with men. The others was gold, water, and provisions enough to last for years. He said to the travelers on the ships, do not return until you reach the furthest limit of the sea, or your provisions and water have run out. They departed, and the period of their absence grew long. None of them returned until a long time had passed. Then a single ship of these travelers came back. We asked their captain, again that's the king talking, we asked their captain what had become of the remnants, or what reports there were of them, what happened to the other boats. He replied, no, Sultan, O king. The reference is again to, I'm sorry, this is Abu Bakr II, his brother, that we traveled a long time until we were faced on the open sea with a water course, having a powerful pull. It sounds to me like the equatorial current, which is to the south of Senegal and the Gambia. Mine was the last of those ships. Those ships went ahead, and when they entered that place, they did not return, nor did they appear to sight, because now they're going to move quickly. They're going to get into the current, and they're going to disappear over the horizon. That's what I believe he's saying. Some people would dispute that. We did not know what had happened to them. Maybe he became frightened, it appears that he did. As for me, I returned from the place I was in and did not enter that water course. He came back. Mansa Musa narrated that Abu Bakr II expressed disapproval with him. Like, why did you do that? Mansa Musa continued to say, then that Sultan, Abu Bakr II, prepared 2,000 boats, 1,000 for himself and the men he would take with him, and 1,000 for provisions and water. Then he left me in power and set out on the Oceanic Sea, what we call the Atlantic Ocean, almost certainly the equatorial current, with those who were with him and journeyed on it. It was the last we saw of him and all those who were with him, and the kingdom became exclusively mine. Again, this has been well researched. It's also possible to do more and more, and I hope someday I'd like to be part of that. Because also in West Africa you have oral traditions. And it's very important because this is an exercise of the state. It's not just a private undertaking. Did Abu Bakr II ever come back? Well, of course, this report is in 1325. And there's no news from Africa. Maybe when he came back, they had come back. We don't know. We don't know if they returned or not. We just know that by the time that Mansa Musa goes to Cairo, they had not returned. Let's take the next slide. Again, remember the currents. And think now of the equatorial current, one of the strongest in the world, that goes from West Africa to America. It's very important, and in our own history, oh my goodness, of the 10 minutes, of early America, of early colonial America, they're always crossing with that current. Columbus crosses with that current. The Portuguese and Spanish crossed with that current. But this man, Alexander Merchant, a historian of Brazil, observes regarding the equatorial Atlantic current that once cast into the mid-Atlantic, that's the equatorial current, it is almost impossible to avoid the South American coast. You're going to come dead or alive, hopefully alive. And again, these are men who are equipped for that. Next slide. So, let's look at some terracottas. These are terracottas from the contact area. And they're interesting, aren't they? He looks somewhat like an African. Very much like an African. In fact, some Africans would say he looks like a Bambara. And there were Bambaras in the kingdom of Mali. They're one of the dominant groups. Look at his hat. Muslims even in this room have hats like that. And then here is a man who, look at his helmet, a Mandinka helmet. He has also what's called a compound earring, which they often wore. And he is distinctively Mandinka. He's very black, you don't have to be told that. And he would be said to be, as I was told this by Mandinkas, Donso, which means a hunter. A hunter. They look at him, oh, he's a hunter. He's a Donso. So they can even identify him. And a hunter, you know, maybe you have to be told what that means. But a hunter is not just a person who goes hunting. A hunter in that culture is a person who has a sixth sense, or he has a special sense, you know, so that he would know where the lion is, where the leopard is, what's the time to hunt, do you go by land, do you go by water, where are the dangerous snakes, where are they not, because snakes are not everywhere. So he will know that, and in that party, the donso, the hunter, is going to be essential. Because you come into forested jungles, and the donso will get you through them. You go through them yourself, you may make it, but many probably will die. Here's another one of the terracottas. He looks African to me. He's got also the helmet, he's also got the he's got the compound earrings. And these statues, these terracottas, are believed to be of roughly the early 14th century. That would be the time when Abu Bakr made his trip. So they are strong evidence. Let's look at the next slide. Here's another one. And this man looks like a Bambara, who are the brothers of the Mandinka, wearing a turban, compound earring, tribal markings. He looks African. Next, and the same period. Next slide. So, some of the many telltale signs, we don't have time, so I'll try to elaborate, but this is wampum, which our native First Nations developed using often seashells, and they'll sew them together, and they use them as money. And the important thing is that the kingdom of Mali also had something like wampum. Leo Wiener contends that you can see the wampum phenomenon spread from the contact area. And I'm not going to say that's true, I can't. But what I'm saying is that let's just be careful and let's be objective and let's look at these things. Also, a Mandinka dog. What's special about the Mandinka dogs? What is special about the dogs, the Cherokee dog? Or the dogs of the First Nations? They don't bark. And the Mandinka dog doesn't bark either. They're barkless dogs. They can actually bark, but they won't bark unless there is immediate danger. That makes a lot of sense to breed them. They're very intelligent dogs. But in Mandinka land, which is not jungle, it has jungles, but it's mostly savanna, it's mostly grassland, you don't want barking dogs at night because they give away where you are, where your village is. Lions can come, leopards can come, you know, raiding parties can come. So it's good to have a dog who will only bark when there's trouble. Whereas in the contact area, assuming that these dogs come through the contact area, you don't really need a silent dog. Because here you have mostly forest. And in fact, you need sound to be able to hear, like drums. And maybe even like a barking dog. So these are interesting parallels. And Leo Wiener is among the people that points them out. Let's take the next slide. Okay, so Cortez in his conquest of Mexico. So he will conquer Mexico a little bit less than 200 years after those ships almost certainly crossed the Atlantic. And this is what he writes. When he came to Yucatan about two centuries after the possible Mandinka landing, he called that area El Cairo. Cairo. He could do that for many reasons. He did not believe he was conquering a new and foreign world, but an extension of the Islamic realms of the old world, like the Muslim cultures he had fought against in Iberia, Spain, and Portugal, Al-Andalus, and North Africa. Pizarro and other conquistadores took similar views of the new world. Of course, they were completely wrong, weren't they? Well, maybe not. And historians will always say, well, these fools, they had Muslims on the brain, and they saw their shadows everywhere. It could be true. Maybe they had other motives that I don't know about, but these were intelligent men. Whether they were good men or virtuous men, that's another issue, because they will destroy whole cultures. When Cortes came into Tenochtitlan, today's Mexico City, the Aztec capital he claimed in this great city. And by the way, the Mandinkans would have been in the pre-Aztec period. They're in the pre-Aztec period. He claimed in this great city there are many mosques, muchas mezquitas, and native temples, indigenous temples, teocalis, and many beautiful buildings. Other Spanish conquerors identified Mexican mosques, like he did, although, unlike Cortes, they sometimes used the word teocalli, native temple, indigenous temple, and mosque interchangeably. Our historians know this. They've read these texts, and there are very many of them. And usually they just say that, what a mistake, what an incredible mistake. They thought they were in a world they weren't in, and they were mistaking what they saw for mosques. Let's take the next slide. This is Castellanos, Juan de Castellanos. He came to the Americas in 1545 and took active part in the conquests. He reported finding Andalusian-like followers of Mahoma, in Venezuela, who were white-skinned, not that it makes a big difference, wore beards after the Islamic fashion. Other conquest chronicles also report the presence of Muslims in Chiapas, in southern Mexico, and in other parts of southern Mexico. This is from a book by Luisa Isabel Alvarez de Toledo, Africa versus America. I'm going to show her picture to you. I had the honor to meet this woman. She's called the Red Duchess. She had access to the archives of the Spanish Armada. And on the basis of what was there, she wrote this book, and she believed that even the Andalusians, not just the Africans, had been able to cross the Atlantic. Let's go to the next slide. This is her, the Red Duchess, and that's her book, Africa versus America, La Puerta del Paradigma. And it's an important book. Again, these things have to be studied. And those of us who are interested in this thesis, and whether it's true or false, we must be very careful to study it carefully and not to become enthusiastic and not to exaggerate. Let's take the next one. And we got 2 minutes, my goodness. Maybe you know about this book, Gavin Menzies, 1421, the year China discovered the world. And this is about a true historical event, which are the treasure ships of the Ming Dynasty of China. And that's true, the Ming Dynasty had these treasure ships. Let's look at the next slide. This is Zheng He. He was the captain. This is another artist depiction of Zheng He. And Zheng He is well known in the Chinese-speaking communities of much of the Chinese-speaking world. In fact, they regard him as an embodiment of good luck. I've encountered that myself in Indonesia, but among the Chinese of Indonesia. So Zheng He, he was a Muslim sea captain, no question about that. He was from Xi'an, which is a great city inside of China, has a beautiful mosque, and in fact, he's one of the people who built that mosque. He paid for a lot of the construction on it because he's extremely wealthy. And he was the chief admiral of the famed Ming Dynasty treasure fleets. He led the fleet in 7 voyages. And these are pictures of what their ships looked like. Let's take the next slide. Other pictures. And the thing is that you see that huge ship? They actually had ships like that. Huge ships that even had gardens in them that raised food for them to eat. And they had lots of other ships with them. Let's keep going. Okay, let's skip this. We don't have time for that. Now, we're about to end. I think we'll make it on time. This man is a scholar who works in Germany. His name is Fuat Sezgin. He's of Turkish background. And he's a master of the history of science and cartography, Islamic manuscripts. He's written some of the most important works of the 20th century and the 21st century. Here you see a picture of him, and what's he got in front of him? These are astrolabes, and these are other tools that Muslims had for navigation, especially, but also for knowing directions and for travel, even by sea. And he knows how to use them, and he also knows how Muslims made their maps. So he wrote this, the Precolumbian discovery of the American continent by Muslim seafarers. He is a big scholar, and he doesn't say things like this lightly. Let's take the next slide. So he doesn't doubt for a moment that Zheng He came to America, because the maps of Zheng He in the Ming Dynasty, they would show that he came to the American coast and he came to other coasts as well. That's why he said 1421, the year China discovered the world. What he says, however, is Gavin Menzies, who wrote the book, he was a submarine captain. And he looked at these old maps and he could see that from a submarine periscope point of view, this is the way the world would look. So he thought that this showed they came to America, they made the maps. But Fuat Sezgin said, the problem with Menzies is he doesn't know anything about the tradition of Islamic cartography, of Muslim map making, because Muslims were great map makers. And also, they had a global civilization. Mansa Khan Khan Musa belonged to that global civilization. So he said that, you know, the maps of Zheng He, and again, I don't mean to offend any Chinese or the genius of the Chinese, but he said that the Chinese would have made their maps in essentially the same way that Muslims did. And even though you had the greatest of ships, you can't make maps in those days, even with 7 voyages, even with this incredible crew. That's what he says. I'm not able to evaluate whether that's true. So he says that Zheng He almost certainly is taking his maps from the Muslims. He was himself a Muslim. He was himself part of that tradition. And here we have a Muslim map. And this is from the Javanese Atlas. Java was Muslim at that time. Of the 15th century, the 1400s. This atlas the Portuguese bought in Java before the discovery of Brazil. They, quote-unquote, discovered Brazil in 1500, and this atlas is before that. And this is the Brazil coast, and not only that, you can see how the Muslims made their maps. And if you studied this, you see how they used the astrolabe and these other tools that Fuat Sezgin knows to make that map. And this is, by those standards, a very accurate map. Let's look at the Brazil coast. Next slide. So here is the part of Brazil that's being depicted. And you might say that's not exact, and it's not. But according to the technology of the time, it is exact enough. And it's almost certainly a map of the coast of Brazil. There are also other maps there. The Javanese Atlas provides a copy of Muslim travel charts elaborated by Arabic Islamic navigators in the 1400s. If not before, the Portuguese discovered Brazil in 1500. The Portuguese general Alfonso de Albuquerque, the Albuquerque New Mexico is named after, sent this map and the atlas, to King Manuel of Portugal. He said, "The Javanese Atlas seems to me the most beautiful thing I have ever seen. Your Majesty will be delighted to see it." So again, this is important evidence. Does it close the case? No, it doesn't. But it does open the case. Let's take the next slide. And that's it, isn't it? But what do we say about the map making? This is what Fouette says about it, is that to make maps, even with that technology, which was very advanced for that time, you couldn't do it in one voyage or two voyages or three. It took actually generations. And I'm not able to say much about that. I just have to accept it or leave it or do more research. But what he means is that the fact that the Javanese had this atlas, and Muslims had other atlases like that, it must indicate that they were crossing the Atlantic for a long time. And why would they do that? Why would, for example, the Olmecs be there? I have a guess, and I may be totally wrong, but I would say gold, because the Americas are extremely rich in gold. And the areas they were going to, or that they were in, were very rich in gold. And when we look at the Kingdom of Mali, for example, it had so much gold, it's almost unbelievable. And some scholars of the Kingdom of Mali have said West Africa could not produce that much. Maybe, maybe not. And we could talk about that, because there's another story there. But if you bring in other sources of gold, especially across the Atlantic, and again, we don't know the full story, but why is Abu Bakr II so intent on going? Why does he give up his kingdom to go? Maybe he comes back. But comes back with what? I would expect gold. So this is probably the motivation, and that's also important. Today, of course, you could go online. You can go to the bookstore. You can buy maps of everything in the world, can't you? Even you can get a map, a Google map, is that what it is, of your own home, showing whether you cut the grass or not. In the ancient world, maps are top secret. You don't publish them and print them. You don't give them out. Why? Well, because they're used for trade, and they are access to markets that you don't want to give to your competitors. And for that reason, maps were kept secret. It's also part of the story. Thank you for listening. And let's open up the floor, if we have time, for questions.
So we were going to do cards, but I think it's a safe enough crowd that we can open up the floor to questions in the audience. Is there anybody who would like to ask Dr. Umar some questions?
Yes. His book is also very important. He's basically using Leo Wiener, and he's adding a few things. He is from Guyana in South America. Sometimes the book is not as academically tight, in my eyes, as I would hope it to be. It's a little bit enthusiastic, and you have to be really careful about that. I would say, ultimately, the book that's really got to be carefully studied is the Ovener. It's a big book. It's an incredible study, in my opinion. Ivan van Sertima, I would say, would be used as an introduction to that book, because he relies on it very heavily. Yes?
So, the purpose you say is for trade, but if the theory is there that these people have settled into the Americas, they have men and they have provisions, but they're missing one key part of creating that next generation. So,
what's that? Women. And that would be because of the fact that they intend to intermarry. And almost certainly did. Almost certainly did. And you're talking about 2,400 boats, 1,200 of which have warriors. And so they almost certainly intermarried. And this is one of the things also that von Butenau talks about is how he says in the Terracottas you can actually see the transition from African-looking people to people who look like the First Nations. So that's a very good question. Thank you. And this is what Muslims did and many other people did. I mean, for example, Islam has been in China since 1,400 years. And it came by trade, and it came also by the emperors themselves. The emperor of the Tang Dynasty, for example, brings some of the first. And he brings armies. And other emperors did that because they wanted Muslim armies to protect the throne, especially from the Tibetans and from the Mongols. And if you go to China, I've had the honor to go there and to study these things. You can actually see in the Silk Road and other areas, the kind of houses that the Muslim generals lived in. They developed special martial arts. A lot of them were ministers of state. And the guides I had, who were Chinese guides, they would show me how, if you just know the structure of the house and the way it's put together, you can tell whether he was an officer, whether he was something else. And he said, these are officers' homes. But also when the Chinese emperors would bring the Muslims, they didn't bring them. They said, just men. Why? So they die out, of course. No. So they become Chinese because he will give them wives. And then they will become Chinese. Yes?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. I had the, thank you very much. I had the opportunity to visit the Zhenghe Museum in Nanjing. And you can see the recreation of the ships and a lot of these maps mm-hmm. from that period, which included tremendous trade in the Indian Ocean, and that tremendous trade spread culture and learning, perhaps even up to Europe, but it was tremendous.
Since you've asked your beautiful question and made your comment, maybe our sister could go back to that book, just before we get to what I said again,
It's this one right here.
Keep going.
Oh, can
you do that?
Yeah, I want this slide.
Yes, go ahead.
But I really appreciate the title for your talk, Muslims in Precolumbian America.
Question mark.
Okay. Actually, but it's looking very interesting, and actually it's more than Muslim.
I do believe in the Mandinka crossing. I have no doubt about that. And I wish that someday I might be able to contribute that research on it. I'm able to go to the Gambia. I love the Gambia. Of course, the Kingdom of Mali is much bigger than that. I just wish that someday I might be able to tap into the oral traditions and to discover things. In any case, what our brother has said about the great treasure fleets, and they went all over the world, I'd like to bring to your attention now the book that I didn't talk about because we were out of time. And this is a book also that if the man is here who asked the first question, it's really good to study. It's very valuable. This is Islamic and European Expansion. And it's edited by Michael Addis. And there's an article in it that is really, to me, pivotal. And that is Janet Abunura. She's an American of Arab Christian background. And she writes, "The world system in the 13th century, dead end or precursor." This is a great historian. I admire her very much. And here she's talking about that world that our brother referred to, which is this incredible economic boom of the 1200s, 1300s, into the 1400s. Of course, this is like 1421 that the book is focusing on. And she'll show you that during this time, an incredible economic system was developed, probably like one the world had never seen before. And this was based in China. And it's very much a part of the Yuan Dynasty, which is before the Ming Dynasty. The Yuan Dynasty is the dynasty that was run by the Mongols who conquered China. And then the Ming will take over after that. And what she shows is that this incredible economic system was developed between China. It involved the Muslim world, and it involved even Europe, even Italy and France and other parts of the world. It had like four nodes. And it is, she would call it proto-capitalist or pre-capitalist. They developed banking, international banking. They developed something like checking, you know, which is hiwala, which Arabs still use to this day, so that you didn't have to carry gold and silver thousands of miles across Asia, for example, which is not only dangerous because of robbers, but it's also heavy. You know, gold and silver, I hope all of you know this, and I think it's not a bad idea to have some gold and silver if you can afford it. You know, of course, it's a bad investment, it goes up and down, but in the end, it's not a commodity. It's real wealth, but it's heavy. It's very heavy, so they developed the hiwala system, that I can have a check-like instrument, paper instrument, go all the way to China and cash it for a whole sack of gold, or the other way around. And this system is a precursor or dead end. In other words, did this lead to the phenomena of banking in Europe and capitalism in Europe, especially in the 15th century, in the 1400s? And again, we have to be really careful. Let's not insist on things before we prove them. But that system ended abruptly. That great economic system is really important. I would like to be able to talk about it for minutes, but it ends really quickly. It shuts down. What happened? I know some of you know. What happened? The bubonic plague, the Black Death. And again, we as people who live in the West, may we be able to cure the West, our brothers and sisters, of myopia, just seeing one view. Of course, we in the West study about the bubonic plague. You may have read about Defoe and the plague journals and so forth, but the way it was presented to me in high school and college, and maybe to you, is almost as if it only happened in Europe. It was only significant in Paris and London, and then we know how it affected feudalism and how it leads to the development of cities where peasants can go and become the beginning of the proletariat. But the civilizations that were really struck down by the plague were ones that were not essentially agrarian, as Western Europe was. And that was China. And it was also many of the other cities of Central Asia, of Muslim Spain and Portugal, of Syria. And this is a really, really good book. It's about globalism. Its introductions are fantastic. If you have any kind of historical inclination, I think you would love it. And then this article, to me, is just a must read. Other questions? How are we coming with time?
15 minutes.
15 minutes. So, any other questions? Yes? Okay, I've had the honor to go to China twice. I have great hopes to maybe go there a third time in the months ahead. On the first trip, which I don't think the second trip was much different, we began in Beijing. We then went out to the Longju, out to sort of, we went to the western part of the Silk Road. We came to Xi'an. We went to a number of different places, and then we ended in Shanghai. And I think in the second trip we did just about the same thing. We added a few things here and there. We were mostly interested in the cultures and civilizations of our Muslim brothers and sisters in China. And that's a really interesting study. I have an article which you can find online called Thinking Outside the Abrahamic Box. No, it's called Islam and China. What is it called? Islam and China, is it called that? Thinking Outside the Abrahamic Box. You can read it if you want, but that, you know, that article's based on those trips, and then also on readings and other things. And that's just, especially for us as Muslims in the United States and Canada and Europe, the Chinese Muslim experience is extremely valuable, especially because of the way that they fit into Chinese culture while still maintaining their Islamic identity. Yes, any other questions? Yes?
The Abrahamic box, is that Ibrahim or Abraham Lincoln?
It's not Abraham Lincoln.
Okay.
It's Abraham the patriarch, the father of the children of Israel. And what I meant to say is that, you know, when we talk about Abrahamic faiths, which is a good thing, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, they're all very similar. They have the same glossary, the same vocabulary, a lot of the same beliefs, a little bit of difference here and there. But one of the things that's really interesting about Chinese Muslims is that they have an extremely interesting dialogue with Pure Land Buddhism, Neo-Confucianism, and Taoism. And this is one of the main things they're seeking, is to relate Islam and the Islamic tradition to Muslims through those traditions. Does that make any sense? Well, again, because one of the interesting things about the Muslims of China is that many of them, certainly not all of them, perhaps not most of them, that many of them were servants of the state. They were generals, they were soldiers, they were ministers of finance. When Marco Polo went to China, the minister of finance was a famous Chinese Muslim, Zheng He. And I don't pronounce it correctly, forgive me. But he also is very famous in China. And these people were trained in the Chinese classics. So they read Confucius, they read Lao Tzu, they read I Ching, the Book of Changes. And therefore, for them to understand their own Islamic religion in Arabic and Persian, by the way, because for the Chinese Muslims, Persian is a sacred language. I could explain to you why. That has to do with Genghis Khan. He brought lots of Persian-speaking Muslims to China. So they were, a lot of them were speaking Persian, and Persian is one of the religious languages of Islam. But for the Chinese Muslims, and this I didn't know this, when I first went to China, I didn't see why these Chinese Muslims were so infatuated with Persian. And then I learned that story later on. But these scholars like Wan Daiju and Liu Ji, they wanted to explain Islam in Chinese terms. Not for the Chinese, not for the other Chinese, but for the Muslim Chinese, because that was their worldview. They'd been trained in the classics. And so Therefore, their book enables the Chinese Muslim to relate to what's there in the Arabic and Persian sources. It's a different worldview. But also at the same time, it brought about a very interesting dialogue between the Muslims and between the Buddhists and the Confucianists and the Taoists. And I talk about a little bit of that in the paper. And also in this process, if not before, they will also rename the Islamic religion. So if you say Islam in Chinese, it comes out something like Yisinan. And then you'd have to take the ideograms and find the ones that produce that, and that might look funny because they don't have anything to do with Islam. And so they would name it, I'm going to try my Chinese, forgive me, Qing Jian Jiao. They call it the religion of Qing, of the pure, and Jian of the real. I mean, like, that excites me just to hear it. You see, and then also it shows that, and this is what they want to show, is that this religion must not be regarded as alien. It's not alien to China. And those of you who are Chinese or know about China, you know that if you did have an alien religion in China, then it might not ever really fit in. It might not really be very popular. And so they didn't want to be seen as alien. And it's to me an extremely interesting phenomenon. Yes?
Can you speak a little bit about like the challenges and opportunities that your work has come up against in the current political contemporary climate?
I say the biggest challenge that my work comes up against is my own laziness. What am I going to do? I hope that we'll be able to work together. And because, again, as our brother Barak Ablu pointed out, before this was never for me academic. For me, this is fascinating. This history is really important. History is identity. But now, in wake of what has happened, and the present regime, I hope that it doesn't become as bad as some people feel, or as it might be. But now this is a very important issue. We are not aliens here, nor are you, if you're not a Muslim. And we never were. I gave another presentation at Town Hall on Muslims in America from 1585 to 1965. That's from the beginning of English colonialism, and we were here, as Barak Ablu said, from the very beginning. Even from the colony of Roanoke, Drake brought 200 Muslims to Roanoke, which he had liberated from a galley, an artillery galley ship in the Caribbean. And these may be the ancestors of Abraham Lincoln, who was a Melungeon, and the Melungeons think they came from those people. And so does Elvis Presley, and so does Clark Gable, and so does Tom Hanks. And whether that's really what happened or not, I mean, Abraham Lincoln has DNA like nobody else's. DNA found in Tunisia, by the way. Now this issue is an issue, of other things instead. In fact, one of the great Muslims in early America after Columbus is Lady Liberty. You know who she is, don't you? Lady Liberty, that beautiful lady that's in New York Harbor, the Statue of Liberty. Did you know she was a Muslim? Because Bartholdi and Eiffel, who made the Eiffel Tower, Bartholdi, like most artists, he based that beautiful woman on a model. And who was that model? She was an Egyptian peasant woman with, God forbid, hijab. Of course, he put a crown on her. Why did he do that? Well, he was fascinated with Egypt. He was fascinated with the pharaonic civilization. And not only that, but the French at that time wanted to make the statue as a gift for Egypt. So that's also part of it. But then, because of the way that things worked out, they gave it as a gift to the United States. Lady Liberty in commemoration of French-American cooperation in the Revolutionary War. But Lady Liberty, you're looking at an Egyptian woman, an Egyptian Muslim woman. And today, isn't that kind of symbolic? That's our liberty. And you can read about this in Smithsonian. Smithsonian came out with an article about that, and no doubt they've known this for a while, but I think they also knew that, like, this is a good story to tell right now. That even your Statue of Liberty, you know, represents a Muslim woman whom you might not even let into the country today. And may we let liberty through the door. Other...
One more question.
Yes, this lady. Yes.
Oh, thank you. I just want to go back to Olmec and the DNA. You just mentioned DNA. So is there DNA work being done in Central America and South America that might substantiate the as physical evidence of it?
If you want to look into that, where you might begin would be they came before Columbus by Ivan and Sertima. Because if my recollection is not correct, I know he talks about genetics, and he talks about also skeletal evidence, and I think he talks about DNA, but please go there and look at that.
And thank you for this fabulous.
Thank you for your compliment. And yes. America. one of the issues that is raised by the Urbino, tobacco. Tobacco is American, right? But the Urbino said maybe not. And even, this is one of the claims that is made in his book and in Ivan Van Sertima, that there are old First Nation pipes for tobacco that have elephants on them. So you have tobacco, you have plants, rice, and you know there are issues about American rice. And I don't think we're talking about wild rice here. But you know, American rice is a combination of certain varieties, and as I recall, you know, from several years ago, that rice almost certainly comes out of West Africa. My own belief is that Senegambia, that region of the Gambia River, one of the most beautiful, incredible rivers in the world, and then the Senegalese rivers, I believe that this is where rice cultivation began. And that's really mostly a guess, but it's not an uneducated guess. And they have all kinds of native varieties of rice, and they have been farming rice for, I would say millennia. Cotton, where does it come from? So you have a lot of issues where you have different types of plants, different types of food that we associate with America. And they were here, no question about that. And again, we don't want to rob anyone of their thunder. We want to be polite and respectful of people. But in many cases, and you'll see this in these books, there is a question of, does it really originate in America or in Africa? And the least we can say about that is, let's take Africa seriously. I love Arnold Toynbee. Those of you who've studied history, you know that name. It rings a bell. I think he's one of the greatest minds of the 20th century, one of the greatest historians and philosophers of history of the 20th century. He does, however, in my opinion, have a big defect. He never took Africa seriously. He looked at, you know, indigenous civilizations in the Americas, the Incas, the Aztecs, and others, but he doesn't really take Africa seriously, and we must take Africa seriously. And especially these civilizations of Senegambia, I believe that they have amazing roots that go back millennia, and other parts of Africa can claim the same thing. May we be open-minded. You're at a university, and you know many of your students, and you know we really have got to, you know, open up the discourse, you know, to search for the truth. What really happened? Of course, if we're Americans, as I am, and I assume that most of you are, you know, what is the history of the First Nations of this land? You know some of that, but maybe we need to tell that story in more detail. It's not an easy story to tell, is it? You know, but that needs to be told. And not because of bitterness or anything like that, but who were they? What did they do? And again, here, their oral traditions are very important. You know, but let's let them tell us their story also. And then, of course, the Africans who were brought here. And this is another thing, too, that if you look at some books I don't have up here, Sylviane Diouf, Servants of Allah, which is about African slaves being brought over, captive Africans being brought over through the transatlantic slave trade. Most of our brothers and sisters of African descent in the United States come from Senegambia. Okay, I think that's pretty well established. They can come from Nigeria and other parts of Africa, no doubt, Mauritania even. But Senegambia, what is today the Gambia and Senegal, this is a core area, and even Joel Chandler Harris, Uncle Remus, and others, they talk about the Harriet Beecher Stowe. But Joel Chandler Harris, he has two books on Aaron in the Wild Woods, and another one's Aaron, and I don't remember. But Aaron is this fictional character that he tells us about, who is, from my reading, Mauritanian. But he does indicate how Aaron ended up as a slave. And then he also tells us in one of those books that most of the Africans came from Senegambia. He uses that word.
they should be taken seriously also. But Aristotle says that if you make a mistake at the beginning, which is, for him, the level of first principles, how do we think? The basic cognitive frames. Then you have a disaster in the details. And that's why we really have, you have to always go back to the beginning. What are our assumptions? What are our rules of thumb? And that's absolutely necessary. And one of the ironic things about the modern West over the last 400 years is that we don't usually do that, believe it or not. And we don't do it very well. We just get going. And as long as you can produce something that works, it's okay. Well, you know, on some levels it is, and on others it may not be. Thank you very much for your attention. And may all go well with you and all go well with us. And I'm really happy to be here on the West Coast. I was in LA before here. I came up here. And, you know, I do feel that the West Coast in the present situation can play a dynamic role. I would say even in the preservation of our liberties that I hope will be done wisely and correctly. And I feel very happy to be here. I feel, not that I would be unsafe, but I remember when I was coming from the Gambia and I have to go through JFK, and New York's not bad, it's good. But people were telling me, you know, remember this, if they stop you, I am an American citizen, I have established my identity, may I speak to your supervisor? I want a lawyer. And then I think I'm being profiled. I said, maybe profile, I'll leave that out. But, you know, my friend said, you know, please remember this because you may be profiled when you come through. Fortunately, it didn't happen. But, you know, at first I came by way of Morocco, then I came to New York, then I came to LA. And this Moroccan woman told me in the airport in Casablanca that you'll go through customs in LA. And I thought, wow, that's great. It didn't happen, though. I went through customs in JFK. And even on the plane, I thought, oh, that can't be true. You're going to go through customs in JFK. And it was nice. I'm thankful for that. And I came out, there's these women there with the big signs, did you see anybody detained? And I waved at them. I went to my airplane. And God bless you all. May we have a safe flight.